Hello, my name is Sandra Mousseaux. Today we are talking to Ms. Jeanne Riesterer, who is the mayor of Roseville. We are here to talk to Mayor Riesterer about the history of Roseville, the present, and even what she can see in the future for Roseville. Good afternoon, Mayor Riesterer.
Good afternoon, Sandra. It's good to see you. Welcome to our town. What would you like to know? I grew up here. I was born, actually, at Melvin and Gratiot. And throughout my life, I guess I've never lived more than three blocks from Utica Road and Gratiot. So I'm truly native to this area. Mm-hmm. So do you have questions, or would you just like me to start by telling you some of my recollections?
You could start by just telling us some of your recollections.
When I was born, I recall the interurban tracks. And I vaguely recall the interurban running, but it quit soon after. I was born in 1926, and that's the time that Roseville became a village. Prior to that, it had been just Aaron Township, but it was chartered as a village, and they think they started in 1925, and in 26, with me, they became a village. And the population, it was truly a bedroom community. It was meant to be. And this, I would use the words of President Harper, who probably was the longest village president, or at least held that office for the greatest number of years. He said it was a good community to raise children, and that's what he foresaw what has become the city of Roseville to be. Later on, we found out that bedroom communities do not support a government very well, so it had to diversify and it had to spread out. But when I was a child, there was probably about 3,000 residents, and the area was 3 miles by 3 miles. And we had a lot of fields. The architecture, I think you could have called it early garage, because a lot of people came here from Detroit and built little garage homes and then gradually expanded it. And the old neighborhoods that started to become typical suburban would be back here, Ivanhoe, Essex. Those streets were where some of our first settlements were. Around 11 Mile Road and Gratiot, there would be little clusters of homes that would spring up. The schools were being built in the early 20s. I went to Pierce School for kindergarten, and the year that I started kindergarten, at age 5, they had 3 students in kindergarten, so they put us all in first grade to make it easier for the teacher, and that class was taught by the principal. After that, I went to Sacred Heart. I finished my education at Sacred Heart. But even in the early years, we had 2 high schools here. We had Burton High School and Eastland High School. My husband was native to here. His family moved out in this area in 1910, and he was born on Martin Road. He went to Pierce and he went to Sacred Heart, but he graduated from Burton High School in 1943. After the war, after World War II, we saw a lot of development. We saw clusters of homes, tract housing being built off of 11 Mile Road. But before that, that was typically that area back there. Bellinger was typical of your old village kinds of small clusters of homes. And when I was 11 years old, I peddled milk back there. Milk was 11 cents a quart. And we brought it in glass bottles. The roads were muddy. They were impassable a lot of times, and then we walked. There were a few sidewalks. I see you've got the toll gate on your notes there, mm-hmm. and the toll gate was very close to what is now Utica Road and Gratiot, and that's where Sacred Heart Church is. That was established years and years ago. They built the foundation of the present church in 1925. The old church stood where the northbound lane of Gratiot is now. That Gratiot itself was improved in the 50s, but when I was small, it was essentially a two-lane kind of concrete ribbon that stretched to Mount Clements. And Utica Road and Gratiot was famous for the Van Hau family. They had a dry goods store there, and then that block that is now the Van Hau block was built by that family. The bank was there. The bank failed in the crash in the early 30s. Roseville has had in its early years, was a kind of a struggling community. People came out here if they couldn't work in automobile factories. They came out here because it was cheaper to live out here. Mm. After it began to develop, after the I got to get back to the toll gate. I'm rambling. I lived in a house that was thought to be part of the toll gatekeeper's house. Hmm. And it was, by the time I lived there, it was at Martin and Gratiot. And in looking at pictures of the old toll gate house, I'm sure that it probably was part of that structure. But you had to pay a toll in the early years to get through, and that's why it was called the toll gate house.
How much was the toll?
Golly, I don't remember, because when I was small, they had forgotten toll. It probably was, let's say it was a quarter. I don't think it was ever any more than that. No, I think there's a sign in the library that says it was a dime at one time.
Mm.
It depended on the number of axles, the same as you do now on the toll roads. Mm. They count the number of axles, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Sacred Heart Church has a very long history, started as a mission and then eventually became a full parish. The cemetery, which is still there and sort of flourishing now, that property was purchased from the Pooper family in 1872. But there were burials there as early as 1863. Mm-hmm. I keep the records there. I have done that since 1971 when we celebrated, we're getting ready to celebrate the centennial anniversary of that cemetery. And most of Roseville's history is buried there and at Erin Grove Cemetery, which is just about as old as Sacred Heart, maybe a little older, but if you read the tombstones, you'll see the names of all the streets that we have in town, in early town. There's the Commons and the Mesleys. I once lived on Mesley Street, which was part of a farm that came as a land grant eventually. And finally, there was but one lot left to the Mesley daughter, and we purchased that property from Margaret Mesley. So all throughout Roseville, if you look, you'll see names, and they always trigger to me some recognition of families that have come and stayed. And that's essentially what Roseville has done. The families have come, raised children, and the parents seem to stay on and on. And then many times the children will go to some other community and come back.
Mm-hmm.
And often I find threads to my roots. I'll be talking to somebody, and I will have gone to school with a parent.
Mm-hmm.
Or so it's kind of interesting.
Mm-hmm.
The police and fire department, city hall, library, well, let's see. The police department at one time was housed at the old city hall, which is at Meyer and Gratiot, and so was the fire department.
Mm-hmm.
Before radio communications, they used to have to put a light on. There was a tower on top of the old city hall and with a light, and then the policemen who were doing their rounds in the city would come to the station, because they were to be dispatched somewhere, or call the station if they were close to a phone. Fire department, they blew a whistle. We had a volunteer department, and so they blew a whistle, and then the volunteers would come in, grab the truck, and I can remember when we had a bucket brigade. The house behind us burned when I was very young, and we had a bucket brigade. So it's come up like all of these departments have. Now we have a very well-run police and fire department. We have a large library that used to be housed upstairs in the city hall and at Meyer and Gratiot. That was just a room with shelves of books. And so we've really come a long ways in those areas.
Yeah.
I see you have Lauer's Feed Store. Mr. Lauer ran a feed store. It's on this side of Gratiot. It's on the west side between Martin and Utica Road. The original building is still there, okay? And then he eventually bought the properties up and owned almost the entire block. He built that block of stores that's down there. And for many years, my father ran a jewelry store in that block. Lauer's was one of the better blocks in town in the early 40s. That was known as the center of town in our shopping community at that time. We had a Kroger store there. We had a C.F. Smith, which was a grocery chain there. A hardware store, shoe repair store, bakery, dairy bar. That was essentially what our shopping centers would be in the late 30s, early 40s. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
The airport, yes, we had an airport at Fraser and Gratiot. It was at one time the oldest airport in Michigan. It was Hartung Airport. When I was first married, had little children, we used to pick mushrooms there. It was a great fertile ground. It is now East Gate Shopping Center and the housing development behind it. And there used to be across the street, building is still there. Used to be, used to be an airport grill. After the airport was sold to developers and then Eastgate came in, that was about the time that you could see the typical suburban neighborhoods grow here. Up until that time, it had been a house and a couple of lots and then another house. But then we began to see the development of the tract housing. 11 and Grosbeck started to develop. That was the first, I believe, Mashmeyer did his thing back there. Then the area on the southeast corner along 11 and then along Fraser Road began to develop. Then our neighborhood's back here, and we took on the characteristics of a real city kind of thing. And with that had to come the mail delivery. And we used to have rural mail delivery, but when my husband came home from service from World War II, he and another young man named Milton Grant, who also was raised here, were the very two first walking mail carriers. And he was a volunteer fireman at the time, and he had to get permission to lock up the bag when the fire whistle blew, and more than one time the bag ended up in the box locked and he went to a fire. Had finished the route then after the fire was out, so that was typical. The Log Cabin Restaurant, that was a classic. That was at 11 and Gratiot, right? If it were standing now, it would be standing right in the roadway for the service drive there. And that was kind of the teenagers' hotspot of our time. That was a great place for hamburgers, and it was our hangout. There was a high school down 11 Mile. Burton High School was not far from there, so it was a good place for us to kind of go and meet and drink Coke. That's about all we had to drink those days.
Did they have dancing in there?
No, we didn't dance. Well, we used to kind of, we had cars. We weren't quite that, it was not your typical drive-in, but it certainly was the watering place for young teens at the time. One thing you didn't make space for there was the telephone company building, which is still standing. It's now the American Red Cross building, and it was not a dial office till 1950. It was a manual telephone office, and that was the largest employer of women in this town. And almost anyone who was raised here, the daughters worked at the telephone company. It was a good employer. Cut over 1950. I worked there. It was the first paying job I ever had. I used to work for my dad, but you didn't get paid when you worked for your father. And I didn't get paid when I peddled milk because my brother drove milk for the company. And then the Roseville Theater. I loved the Roseville Theater. When I was a kid, we used to be able to get in for a dime. And that was a great Saturday afternoon. We got our chores done. We could go to the Roseville Theater. One time I recall, a manager when I was a little girl was named Jeff Williams. And one time my dad took us to the show at night because my mother was ill. And we got there too late for the cartoons. I can't even remember what the picture was. But I remember after the show was over and the lights went on, I was crying, and Mr. Williams said, "Why are you crying?" And I said, "Because I didn't see the Mickey Mouse." And he had the projectionist run the cartoon for me.
So, nice.
Yeah, that was typical of the town those years. You knew everyone, and everyone knew you. So everyone knew our dog also. So now, there's got to be some questions about something that I may have missed, something you've heard or...
Can you talk about the development of Gratiot itself?
Sure. It like I said earlier, it was a two-lane kind of ribbon link to Mount Clemens. And then as people began to flee Detroit, and that was in the early 50s, they began to widen, then it became the double highway that it is. We used to have parking in between Gratiot Avenue. And I'm sorry, you know, our median is gorgeous. It is nice. I'm sorry we lost that character. It was very handy for the store owners. One of our problems in this town is the small businessman whose stores face Gratiot now on either side has no place to park for their customers.
Yeah.
And that's a problem of the city council, because if you look toward the lots in the neighborhood to dedicate them as parking areas, then you're encroaching on the residences. And so it truly is a problem that we haven't solved as a city. Our boulevard now is gracious and it is beautiful. And I know the Beautification Commission would not ever want to see parking go back there. Truly, I don't think you could cross-grass it to get to a store right now the way it carries the traffic that it does. But it's definitely an artery, and it always was in terms of a link. It was the link from Detroit to Mount Clements. And at one time, we were just a spot on it. But eventually, we developed. I think we developed more character than our immediate neighbor to the south. We became a town, a city of note, much faster than East Detroit. East Detroit kept its small town character. We did not. We became an individual community. So.
Well, what do you see for the future of Roseville?
Well, Roseville's future, I look at her as an aging woman, and aging women have some problems in terms of some cosmetic things. We need to keep up our appearance, and so we need to continue to look at the old properties. One of the things we haven't done, and it's a shame, and we have to be very careful, we have to save some of our buildings that are historical. We didn't save the town hall building, and that was too bad. We very recently condemned a building at Melvin and Gratiot that was truly, at one time, we had hoped to get it an historical designation, but the property owners didn't cooperate, and so we lost the building to age. That's one of our biggest problems. In terms of trying to stay current, we are not hanging on to our history, and that's too bad. Mm-hmm. There are a few structures left now that we can say have the character and the history that we need to get designation for them. And so that's something that we really truly have to look to, preserving everything we can of our history. We are pretty well built. Our lots, we have few vacant lots, and we're going to have to look to growing up instead of out. We need to look to some things in the area of high rise, and especially where we have the intersections of our interstates, because traffic comes to Roseville. If they don't come into Roseville, they certainly come through it. And we need to take advantage of that, because economically, it's important to us. I think it's a stable community, and it always will remain a stable community, and that has its advantages.
Mm-hmm. How about the future of the schools in Roseville?
The schools in Roseville, I think eventually, you know, at one time, it was just, and that was, late 60s, we were bursting at the seams, and then came along the zero population growth and the fact that people don't readily move out. They came here, raised their families, and stayed mm-hmm. here. The children moved out. I think that right now we can offer to the people a community that where the housing is not outlandishly expensive, and young people will come back. I see that Roseville community schools will become vital again. They've had a bad time of it in the last few years. Mm-hmm. And we need to do two things. We need to make sure the curriculum is one of the best, and we need to look to the future children. And we need to save some of our school buildings. They're not doing that. They need money, but they need to save some of those properties, because I think in a few years we will again see a rather large child population here.
Thank you.
You're welcome. It's been a pleasure. I didn't give you hardly any chance to speak.
Well, that's all right. It's interesting listening to you.
Oh, I could probably talk all night.
Cool.
Yeah.